You know how when you're going really fast that you start to get a little bit jittery, nervous? That's what's happening. My nerves are jittery. I was really flying high yesterday and did a tremendous amount of output. It was just a tremendous day, but boy, I had a hard time calming down from it. It's very intense, and intensity continues. The veil is being lifted, and I'm seeing so much of what's going on, and it's somewhat shocking, you know. And I realized this morning, wow, everybody, all the sides of these different factions, they all want a catastrophe to happen. This is what I saw. It all benefits them. They see benefit for it. There's these different factions actually, and I'm able to recognize what's going on now. And the main thing is they all want a catastrophe to happen. Now, let's get into this a little bit. Welcome to the video. I'm, you know, in the wow shock of just the progress, and we probably all are. So we have to realize that, and don't you know, just you have to do full stop in it a bit. Don't get too jittery. So we've already said something that's quite extraordinary here. All sides, except Jesus, this is what Jesus is bringing, the truth, which is this practice. We can flatten out all concepts, including our concept of the past, the future. All concepts can be flattened out, and this is the essential practice. This is the way to move on with honor, honoring our creativity at the same time setting down the dream of death. This is, and from this perspective, we don't need a catastrophe. We don't want a catastrophe. But I have seen what the factions are and how each faction sees that a catastrophe would really help their cause. Now, what are factions? Factions are just merely different ways that we're trying to reach authentic death, that spirit's trying to be authentically dead. And since the spirit cannot be authentically dead, there's bound to be conflict, and there's bound to be projection of failure onto others. And so that splits into factionism here. Absolutely, it does. The dream of death always will be split into conflict. And there's a great deal of conflict going on right now, actually. And just seeing it, oh my gosh, wow. Now, some say that the scientists, which is one faction, which is the belief that death can come about through the modification of nature, authentic spiritual death can come out by the modification of nature. They're trying to bring about a catastrophe with the CERN accelerator. Okay, a lot of people know about this. I haven't emphasized it, but we'll mention it. They're trying to bring about a disruption at subatomic levels, and this is, they think it would be beneficial. There's another group that believes that nature, just leaving nature as it is, will bring about the authentic death. And so they're very much wanting to return to a more prosaic, natural life, a pagan life. Pagan life. Those, they say, no, nature just as it is. Let's celebrate nature just as it is. Let's not try to change or modify it in any way. That this will bring about an authentic death. And they are trying to bring about, I believe, an asteroid to hit this planet to produce a severe famine. And they feel this severe famine and severe problems, I mean, this will collapse civilization and we'll go back to a much more pagan nature worshiping time. There's various factions. Hard times seems to benefit a lot of people in a lot of ways, actually. Ideologues, they feel that, for instance, the Irish potato famine drove the Irish into the Catholic Church. Before, it wasn't that way, actually. We think of the Irish or Catholics, but that's a recent phenomenon. I mean, throughout history, the Catholicism in Ireland, I mean, was very Celtic, actually. The women were bishops. I mean, the women held enormous power and influence in Celtic civilization. And the Catholicism they adapted were still worshipped Mary and Bridget, their pagan goddess. And the women held, you know, tremendous authority and power. And so there, that in, and then the potato famine came. I mean, the British, you know, insisted that the pastures be turned over to their sheep to, you know, to feed the colony, you know, feed the wealthy people, and et cetera. And then they went to monoculture because of that with potatoes. And then the blight came, potato blight, and you know, people starved to death. It was horrible. And then they went into the Catholic Church to say, what did we do wrong? We have to get absolution out, you know. And so it benefited. They ended up benefiting the Catholic Church. And there's a whole other story of modern times right now where, you know, the Celtics are trying to get revenge for that, no question about it, trying to use the church, Catholic Church, to get revenge for the grievances of all that. And a lot of the radical feminists are within the Celtic tradition, working within the Catholic Church to change it, or outside of it, to try to pull it into, you know, doing what they want to do, which they want to, I mean, essentially they want a female pope, female bishops, you know, put Mary in charge of the church, and they want to completely change the church. And they feel that, you know, disaster would help that. They could blame the disaster on that, the exclusion of women from the church of authority. They can blame it all on that, and they would feel they would be able to completely change the entire church structure and go back to the Celtic pagan structure of goddess worship, maintaining, though, the administrative hierarchical authority sort of situation. So, now, we've talked about an asteroid. And there's other factions too. And NASA says, of course, there's nothing. Okay, now is NASA lying? Here's the thing, not necessarily. And this is where it gets really uh-oh. So you have to kind of like take a deep breath here. Because keep in mind that we are spirit and we're dreaming. Okay, this is all a dream. We are manifesting this dream. Spirit is. Spirit is complete sovereign. Spirit can manifest anything, both in a dream and not in a dream. So, the fact that NASA says we don't see any incoming objects, so what? If the collective consciousness, if there's enough desire here for an asteroid to hit the planet, believe it or not, that will precipitate an asteroid. It will appear. And it will come in and hit the planet. So right this moment, NASA says, we don't see anything. Well, there may not be anything to see. It could be it's a thought form. That's everything here are just representations of thoughts. They're all thought forms. So if we generate a thought form of an asteroid coming in, it can come from a standpoint, if it wanted to be a sudden surprise, it can suddenly appear very close to this planet at full speed. Because we just simply precipitated it as a thought form into this gross materialistic dimension. And you say, uh-oh, yeah, this came to me this morning. The Holy Spirit told me that. I said, uh-oh, wow, I never thought of that. Yeah, so I know the conspiracy theorists are always blame NASA for this and this and this and this and this. And NASA says, no, we really don't. And you know, it could be. It could be true. They don't know. Because it's not visible. It's not visible because it's in subtle form. It's in subtle form. It's a thought form. Like everything here is a thought form. Everything's a thought form. And if there's enough desire to have the disaster on this planet, that can precipitate it from a subtle form into a gross form, and it suddenly will strike the planet. And NASA will say, we didn't know it was coming, we didn't see it. And people say, liars. No, not necessarily at all. Is they simply didn't see it. Now, there are some who say that by using infrared telescopes and various other means, that they can view subtler forms in the universe. That's possible. And they may know that it's coming. They may see it in a subtle form. Or you know, there's some ways to detect subtler thought forms. However, the good news is, if we decide, no, we don't want a catastrophe, let's not have a catastrophe, then it will not precipitate into this gross dimension, and will remain in the subtle dimension, and will not impact the Earth, will not impact us. So this is like Twilight Zone stuff, but this is what we're really dealing with, and this solves a great mystery about NASA and scientists. Scientists are usually deal with just the gross realm. Not all. Some scientists are dealing with the subtle realm, and they may be saying, those are the ones maybe saying, hey, you know, there's this potential for a catastrophe. Here's a potential, but it has to do, I see, with us here in this world, those who feel that they would benefit from such a catastrophe. And there definitely are large factions of this world who feel that a catastrophe would be greatly beneficial to them. And that's the problem. So we represent those who say no. A catastrophe would not be beneficial to us. We are not asking for that at all. Peace, stability, ability to practice like this. This is what we're after. This is what we want. We want to relax from fear. We don't want strife and chaos and martial law and catastrophes, etc. We do not want that. And this also answers the question, well, what about the predictions of stuff that we, people say this could happen? If we don't change our ways, this could happen. And then it doesn't happen. They say, oh, you were just lying. That, no, it's not true. There are seers that see the potential that what we're asking for is coming upon us. And if we don't change what we're asking for, it's going to hit us. It's going to, you know, we're going to experience it. And then people repent, meaning they change their mind about what they want, and it doesn't happen. So it's like prophets in the Hebrew Bible. You know, they warned, said, this is what you're asking for. This is what's going to come upon you. They claim, you know, God is the wrath of God. It's not the wrath of God. It's our own wrath upon us. We're trying to bring about an authentic death. And so we decide, this is how we want to do it. And the prophets say, hey, you're going to bring this, you know, catastrophe upon your city, upon your land, if you don't change, repent. And sometimes they repent, and sometimes they don't. My neck's trying to seize up here. So, we can change our mind about what we want. And so this can be preventative. Absolutely. So I've definitely gotten warnings about catastrophe to come. But that doesn't mean that's going to come. Or if it does come, those who called it here and want it, they may find themselves actually precipitating a whole world around this catastrophe and troubles. And the ones that don't want it, didn't call it, they may find that those who want it will be sort of, as it were, like lowering down into lower vibration, lower density to experience it. And we may find ourselves parting ways with that. Like, it was almost as if there were two worlds, and now we find ourselves in a very beautiful world like that. That is very possible. People might call it an ascension, but it might be more like a descension. Those who want, you know, feel that they want to keep pursuing an authentic death will seem to descend. And we don't want to get pulled down with them. Nice white noise there. So this is some very heavy information, to say the least. The idea that just because NASA doesn't see anything, it means we're okay is nonsense. And they don't necessarily have to be lying to us at all. It just could be in subtle form at this point. But there are many factions. That's a very strong call for catastrophe here in this world to benefit. That this would shake things up and then allow this power grab to take place. That's called fomenting a crisis in order to further your ambitions. And there are many who operate this way. And And it's going in that direction. Like the Catholic Church is a perfect example of it. There's no question. I already said the church age is finished. It's over. So it's a moot point as far as we're concerned. Now let's get back to Jesus. This is central. He's already back. But all these factions who want a catastrophe refuse to recognize he's back. Because he doesn't bring catastrophe. He says there's a better way. We don't need it. And so he's useless. You know, he's useless to all these factions. Really, they don't see any use for him. So of course they're going to ignore him. Of course, that's what I saw. I said, I'm back. Everybody was ignoring him. I said, what the heck? What is going on here? This is crazy. And I said, well, I'm not going to ignore you. That's too much. That's ridiculous. We can do better than that. We can do better than that. So we're just trying to do better than that, you know? So I'm speaking up. Didn't Jesus say that when he comes back, he's going to be looking for those who proclaimed him and said, hey, you know, Jesus is the way. And if you don't speak up, if you have information, you don't speak up, he says, it's like I don't know you, because you'll act like you don't know me. So what he's really saying, you'll act like you don't even know me. So definitely I'm speaking up and doing everything I can to get the word out that there is this other way. Absolutely there is. So we can talk about this other way, this other option we have. And it comes from actually practicing. How do we get this? Well, this practicing, I'm neither practicing nor not practicing. I'm neither practicing nor not practicing. I'm both. This is the form I use. I'm both practicing and not practicing. So this is the basic form I like to introduce. Keep introducing this. Now, what's the benefit of this? What I saw this morning was when we using this actually flattens out conceptuality. So we're putting conceptuality in the format of zero. Okay. So whatever we're practicing, no matter what we think of, zero it out. Now, there's a right way to do this and a wrong way. You don't zero it out by saying like, well, I'm both believing in truth and lies. That's not how you do it. You say, I'm both believing in truth and not believing in truth. I'm both believing in lies and not believing in lies. So take use a singular concept, truth, and say, I'm both focused on truth and not focused on truth. Don't say, I'm both focused on truth and lies. That doesn't zero it out. That doesn't zero it out at all. That's just conflict. So we say, I'm both focused on truth and not focused on truth. This zeroes it out. Now, when concepts are zeroed out in this way, they're flattened out like a zero. They're still like a symbol, like a zero symbol, a zero, but it's all flat, okay? So what happens then, and what I understand happens is this condition we call bliss. This is what accompanies it. So really, bliss is easily gotten if we just do this practice, just flatten our concepts out. I have to keep loosening the shoulder up. It's the left is upset with me. It seems like, wow. Yeah, unusual. Wow. Pain in the neck. A real pain in the neck, they think. No, we're not a pain in the neck to anyone. We're not trashing anyone. We're offering a better way. So bliss is what comes about. This seamless feeling. You could call it a seamless feeling. It's not a reactive feeling. It's not up and down. It's not oscillating. It's not reacting. It's not a feeling that reacts, is reacting anything. It's a feeling that accompanies this zeroed out conceptuality. And so we could just abide in bliss. It's that simple, actually. So really, I feel just by doing this practice that bliss will come. It's that easy. And we might think, well, I have to do it for a long time. I don't think so. Keep in mind, an example of Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj, his teacher gave him, say, just feel the I Am presence and just stay with that. And he did that, and it didn't take him long. It took him several years, and that was it. But actually, we could do it even faster than that, much faster. The issue is nobody does it. So there's a practice that works. It's not that the practice doesn't work, it's that nobody does the practice. This is the frustration I'm sure that Jesus has, is it's not difficult at all. Just zero your concepts out and get comfortable with that. And as you get comfortable with that, then the bliss will come. It's already there. You shouldn't make bliss something you try to attain directly. It automatically is there when concepts are zeroed out. So getting used to practicing zeroing out your concepts is the fast way. It is the fast way. And we need a fast way now, because these folks in the world are definitely calling for a catastrophe to happen on this planet, whether it be this type or this or some other type. They're absolutely calling for it. Very ambitious, these people. They want their mode. They believe their way of attaining authentic spiritual death is the way, and that the others are blocking it. So we have to, when we try and do the impossible, we have to project failure on someone else and then blame that they're the ones that's why it's not working. It's because of them. So these groups are very much at odds with one another, and they feel that if they can gain the upper hand, you know, they're going to win, and they're going to finally find the happiness they've been looking for. So they feel catastrophe would give them the cover, the necessary cover, to make their move and best the other side and get rid of them. And for instance, the Catholic Church, again, they're those who say, oh yeah, we need the church, we want it. It's just that men are running it, that's the problem. If women were running it, then it would be effective. Like the magic would then suddenly be effective, you know. The magic of causing spirit to actually die would actually work, you know, whereas it hasn't worked yet. Because some men said, well, it's a mystery how it works, you know. And of course it's a mystery, because it doesn't work. I mean, what else you can say? Either you can say it doesn't work, or it's a mystery, and I can't explain it, but you just have to keep believing it and praying and doing these rituals, and eventually it will work. And so the women say, hey, wait a minute. You know, not the women, but just the ego says, hey, wait a minute, you know. Okay, let's keep all the magic, the rituals, let's have all this stuff, but let's put women in charge, and then the magic will work. Of course it won't at all, but that's their hope. So that is their hope, and they, you know, we think, how in the world could that happen? Well, a severe global catastrophe could absolutely make it happen. And there's a ton of women right now in the world who are actually have trained themselves and prepared themselves to take over the church. Actually, they're chomping at the bit, and yet the structure, male structure, is still there. So they say, how in the world are we going to do this? Well, a catastrophe. So subconsciously, they're pulling in a catastrophe. So then the whole thing could be blamed. They could then blame it. They say, well, just like the potato famine, they blamed their lack of faith, you know, the potato famine, on their lack of faith in the church. The church used that. So it's your lack of faith. And they said, okay, then we'll go into the church. Well, they can blame the catastrophe on the male leadership of the church. And then that will give them the power to change it. And the Pope actually is opening the door for that. The present, well, he's not a Pope anymore. I excommunicated him, rightfully so. He's actually a pivotal player in pivoting the entire situation away from the leadership that has been in place and saying, yeah, it hasn't worked because we didn't have the right leadership. You know, not because it's impossible, but we just didn't have the right leadership. Okay, this is our folly that we continue to pursue. And then those who believe that we can arrive at authentic spiritual death by manipulating, changing nature, they feel that the catastrophe would give them cover for implementing, you know, science to rule the world, saying it was religion that caused this problem. You idiots, you know, somehow, you know, you caused this to happen, or you know, they say if you would have put more faith and investment in science, we would have been able to identify this asteroid before it hit, and we would have been able to destroy it. And you had your attention on God, your Bible, and God, and all this stuff, and that's why we failed, you idiots. We don't want this to ever happen again. We're going to put up a super scientific society, you know. So they would use that to gain the power they want. You see, again. But this is false, because this asteroid cannot necessarily be seen right now. It's very likely in subtle form, and can very like that become manifest in our dimension. So, but they're saying, no, if you just invested instead of any of this, we'll get rid of religion. That's ridiculous. There is no, obviously there's no God, or God would have stopped the asteroid from coming in, right? Yeah, at the same time, those who are believing in quote-unquote God are the ones, you know, praying for it to come in. And so are the scientists. You know, everybody is hoping there's some disaster, and then they can blame it on the other, you know? Blame it on the other. The blame game. It gets very crazy, the blame game. The religious people would say, well, that's God's wrath for the scientists messing with nature. You see, God wants us to go back to a simpler time where there's no science, and let's, you know, nature, God made nature to be a certain way, you know, and so we need it to be that way. So it's God's wrath upon the scientists, and the scientists say, no, this is what happens when you don't invest in science, and we don't have the appropriate instruments and spaceships and everything to see the asteroid coming in and be able to explode it before it gets here. And either it's religion that caused this problem. So it's a perfect setup for the blame game, both sides wanting to dominate. And the blame game gets extraordinarily nasty under some such circumstances. And that's why people start losing their mind. You know, they say, oh my gosh, I can't, I don't know, who do I blame? I mean, I don't understand again. So it's awful. And you can feel we're going into this right now. I mean, it is really, really, really nasty what's going on. Fortunately, Jesus is back. And those, again, who want to play the blame game refuse to recognize it. And most people are still in that thinking, well, if I just blame the right people, then I'll be okay. Yeah. If I just blame the right ones for preventing an authentic death to happen, then I'll be okay. The authentic death of spirit. Then I'll have the authentic death, and then I'll be resurrected, and everything will be fine from then on. Of course, that doesn't work. It never will work. Never, 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 never will it ever work. Not even the slightest possibility it could ever work. Blaming someone else for preventing the impossible to happen is a absolute folly, and will always be absolute folly. The impossible cannot happen. So, conceptually, there are no concepts in reality. Reality doesn't give rise to concepts. Only the attempt to do the impossible gives rise to concepts. So as we flatten out concepts, the dynamic of blame and trying to do the impossible and judgment is not there anymore. And since the thinking, the judging, all of that, it's not there. It's flat. And then this is where the bliss is felt then. Serenity, peace, calm, seamlessness, quiet, stillness, just, you know, it's just wonderful. This wonderful bliss is there. That's what we will experience. So introducing this practice is essential, but from my experience is people don't practice. We don't practice. We're too still caught up in wondering if we can just blame the right person, you know, even just one person. And this is what Jesus tells us, no, not even one person. Don't make any exceptions. You know, we're a lot of us are trying to find, well, maybe I just that one special person that it's their fault. In some way, it's their fault. You know, if it just weren't for what they're doing, I would finally succeed. You know, so all concepts are in play then. All concepts are in play. All judgments are in play, actually, there. Because it doesn't work. And therefore, how do you explain that it doesn't work? And how do you try to attack and defend yourself? And what's the right this, right that? And it just, you know, the yeast of that just blows the dough up into, you know, all this complexity. So with bliss, there's no complexity. No complexity at all. So I'm getting ready for bliss. I have to. I had this dream where, you know, bliss is coming to me. There's no question about it. Holy Spirit gave it to me. And so I have to be able to explain it to others and help them focus on it. The people can say, well, how'd you get this bliss? That's what I want, you know. But they're going to think, well, you must have gotten rid of the bad guys or bad girls, you know. You must have, who did you get rid of her? What's your ideology? Or what concepts did you use? And what's your magic? And, you know, and all this stuff. And then, you know, you have to fend that off. And you have to explain, no, just do this practice. Flatten your concepts. That's all you need to do. And, of course, likely very few will do it at first. Continuity, fear, a lot of reasons get in the way. But certainly I have to be able to fend that all off and say, you know, this is why it is. flatten your concepts and then be able to at least help those who want to do so. And it's just a matter of practicing, getting used to it, realizing, oh, I can do this. I actually can do it. We don't realize we can do it. Yeah, I had a dream last night. Wow. It was, maybe that's what's, causing the problem. I experienced the ferocity, of the left, the radical feminists, the ferocity and the false scale that they'd give me. They were weighing myself on this false scale, saying, hey, that's not the right scale. I want that flat scale. This is the wrong scale. It's giving me some huge reading. I said, that's not the right reading. That's way too heavy. When you get on the true scale of zero conceptual, there's no weight at all. No weight, meaning no weighting. The scale of weighting. Okay, weight is a play on words. False scale means you got to wait a long time. So it's like 238 or some long time. I don't know. I was getting these high readings. I said, that's not right. Where's my scale? And someone had, and then this lady there was like outside the bathroom, like just screaming, roaring at me, shrieking. The shrieking was like impulsing me. The ferocity, the intensity. The women are able to channel this more subtler intensity, often the screaming, the shrieking, the screaming, which is what pagan women use that impulse men into either sex or violence, actually, which is very similar. The both sex and violence actually come from the same sort of impulsive thing, and they decide then, the woman decides which way she wants it to go, actually, to try to impulse the men. And I understood this, what's going on. So there's going to be this shrieking of the women in the world, certain radical feminists who that ideology, which has permeated culture, and it's designed to impulse men. I experienced this. I said, wow, not good. We have to be able to be immune from that. And this is what the bliss does. This is immunity from that. The bliss cannot be impulsed. The only way you can be impulsed is if you have concepts and judgment. Some people call that the reptilian brain of being impulse, sex violence thing, which you see on television and movies constantly. That's purposeful. They want to get you used to that, used to being impulsed. And you'd be very surprised. The pagans used to, they worshipped the goddess, the raiding nomads, and the very warlike, and the women would actually do the rituals and stuff to get the men ready for war and to go out there with just ferocious warriors, actually dye their hair red, shrieking, and do all these various things that they did. They'd bring up these rituals, get men in this just insanely impulsive state, like robots, actually. Yeah, and they're going into war, they're like robots. They don't identify just destruction. They don't even see themselves as vulnerable to death or anything like that. They're just out there to wreak destruction. And this is, there's a whole science to doing this. There's a whole way of doing it. And it starts with the women, actually. And so this is what the church suppressed. A lot of stuff. It suppressed that. It suppressed a lot. It suppressed all those rituals. It suppressed the usage of that female power, and that's what they want back. They want men to be impulsive again. Like dogs, they want to be good dogs and then attack dogs. And so Jesus says no to that. No, 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 no. He says, let everyone flatten concepts is the way. That's how to set down the dream of death. Not to attack your enemies. Not to attack your enemies. The so-called enemies of success. The enemy, there is no enemy of success. There isn't any success possible. So how can there be an enemy of success? This is what we have to realize. So we don't need to use judgment to judge, who is our enemy? Who's the enemy of our success? This is what judgment is really about. Who is the enemy of our success, of our happiness? Who is the enemy of our happiness? There isn't any enemy, because it's impossible. God's not our enemy, because there isn't any option to change the will of God. So you can't say God's an enemy. An enemy stands in the way of what you, of you getting what you want. There is no getting what can never exist. It's not possible. So we don't need judgment. We think we need judgment to determine who's our enemy. But there really isn't, there really isn't any enemy. And this is why we cling to judgment. We think it's essential in our, for happiness. Our happiness depends on right judgment. But Jesus says our happiness depends on no judgment. So fundamental difference, isn't there? Fundamental difference. The ego says our happiness depends on right judgment. Jesus says our happiness depends on no judgment. And yet we're so used to judgment, we're terrified to be completely without it. So this is why I say flatten out your judgment. Flatten out your concepts. The potential, you can see that this is the potential that I laid out around zero. Zero, everything's laid out at this in the plane of zero, as it were. And you can see, oh wow, that's all the stuff I used to judge between, but I'm not judging anymore. So it's a soft landing to let go of judgment. So when we say I'm both judging and not judging, isn't that the final judgment? Yes. The final judgment is to say, I don't need judgment. But we do have that final judgment. So I'm both judging and not judging. I'm both seeing the truth and not seeing the truth. You see, it's judgment can be subtle. If we say, I'm judging that I'm seeing the truth, that's a judgment. Or say, well, I'm judging I'm not seeing the truth, that's a judgment. We're getting to flatten so there's no judgment. Reality doesn't require us to say, I'm judging that I'm experiencing reality. That's not a requirement. So, I'm both experiencing reality and not experiencing reality. So what we do is we put this in the form of judgment, everything in the form of judgment, but in the zero form of judgment, and it's zeroing out the judgment. And this enables us to solve the continuity problem, honor our creativity, at the same time allow bliss, the feeling of bliss. We'll have the feeling of bliss. And we certainly don't need any catastrophe. And if they decide to, you know, call catastrophe into this planet, you know, we will somehow be on a side, you know, that's a side trip to us, and we're not going to be there on that. We're not going to go on that side trip. So just hearing that this is possible, you know, is maybe enough, but it's probably better that we start practicing some. But just to realize that, oh yeah, now I'm seeing, wow. Yeah, there is a huge difference. The ego says right judgment will bring happiness. Jesus says no judgment will bring happiness. And no judgment, how do we represent no judgment as an intermediate step? Zero it out. Flatten it out. How can we judge unless there's concepts to judge between? There's no judgment in reality at all. There's nothing to judge. It just is. So we need concepts to judge. Is this the right one? Is that the right one? But if we flatten all concepts out, where's the judgment? Where is the judgment? We can just say, oh, I see it's all flat. It's all zeroed out. And we can even zero that one out. I'm both seeing that it's zeroed out and not seeing that it's zeroed out. And there are, you know, there are some tricky permutations that you know, but we just keep zeroing it out, accepting it's zeroed out. That's, Wow, lovely white noise there, huh?
Lovely white noise there.
That's pretty bad. That's the agitation of the world. Now, don't underestimate the bitterness of the world and the grievances that people are holding. And we see this in the political realm right now in the United States. It's just exploding into view. I mean, it's just, wow, the apocalypse is being, the veil's being ripped off the whole situation. And there's extreme, you know, vehemence and anger and grievances. That are boiling beneath the surface, and they're coming to the surface now, and as you know, potentially catastrophes, potentially not set in stone, though potentially. You might say everything that happens here is potentially could happen or not happen. Actually, if we see a better way, we'll say, "Oh no, we don't need that," and this is the better way, zeroing out. So I want to, you know, make myself, you know, do the best I can, but also I'm under a lot of stress and strain, to say the least. Taking the initiative on this, I know I say RIP, no remedy, no initiative, no plan, and rest in that. That zeroes out our concepts too. It helps us zero out. I'm both taking the initiative and not taking the initiative. I'm both planning and not planning. So don't allow judgment, you know, flatten out, so we get used to not using judgment. Again, our happiness comes from no judgment. Because reality is this perfect singularity, is a perfect oneness, perfect isness of absolute perfection. There isn't anything else to judge. So judgment never arises. Judgment cannot be just for one, that's not judgment. It's judging me among tunas, so to speak. Like, you can either have this or not have this. You know, two options. Reality is not an option. It's all that is. So there's no judgment around reality at all. It's only when we're trying to figure out, you know, how to do the impossible. We say, maybe this is it, maybe this is it. Oh, you know, then judgment seems to arise for us. How can I really die? How can I by pretending to be dead, how can that finally satisfy, you know, guilt, that judge, that imaginary judge to say, oh yes, okay, you finally died. We say, really? Are you sure? Where's the happiness? I don't feel it. Maybe you're just trying to, you know, it's an imaginary judge, so it doesn't matter what it says. It's just judgment. We judge, you know, what's going to be effective, what will be effective, what's more effective, what's less effective. So what we do is zero it out. So yeah, this is both this and not this. So yeah, I'm both being successful and not being successful. I'm both zeroing it out and not zeroing it out. I'm both trying and not trying. And see, our judgment doesn't know what to do. It's not brought into the picture, is it? This is full stop in the wow. No judgment. This is what really full stop in the wow is all about. Neutral. Go into neutral. Don't judge whether I'm succeeding or not succeeding. So it's a suspending of judgment is what we're after. But we can actually practice directly now zeroing out judgment through flattening concepts. And then automatically bliss will arise from this as we succeed in doing this. Bliss will simply be there. That's the condition of a zeroed out judgment is bliss. And I think this radical feminist woman was furious at me for doing this, saying this is bliss, is, you know, because their whole thing is that sex is bliss and violence is bliss and this kind of thing, and so to be teaching that, no, bliss comes from zeroing out concepts like this, and it is they feel that's interfering with their, you know, authentic death and finding happiness. they try to use bliss to keep waiting for an authentic death. It's body bliss, so to speak, judgmental bliss like that. So there's this big, you know, they don't want genuine bliss to be present in the world at all. So I'm aware, I was aware of this hatred of what I'm doing, you know. But it was just a dynamic thing. I don't take it personally. It's just, this is, surrounds this dynamic of trying to prevent bliss, the example of bliss to be in the world. Try to prevent it. And this extreme focus on sensuality, sexuality, that you know, is really being pushed by women, actually. They're the ones who are, you know, ferocious about it. And they're impulsing a lot of men. And the men are just going along with it like robots, basically. But if you really talk to men honestly, and you won't snitch on them, you know, they'll tell you. Says, "Wow, you know, this is we don't want this kind of situation." You know, it's really the women are pushing it. You know, pushing their sensuality, pushing their body, pushing all that. It's saying, you know, this is what's great. This is what's wonderful. The female body is the answer, and this is what's going to bring you happiness and bliss and all this kind of stuff. You know, it's those folks who are, you know, very, very strident about it, actually. And that's what I experienced, absolutely. Very strong stridency. So this unhinged my nerves a little bit. But it's a wow thing, like, wow, they're really worried, you know, they're really desperate. Which is good, that means we're getting there. The bliss is very close. The zeroed outness is very close here. You know, any faction wants to say, no, we have the happiness. And see, here's the promise of it. You know, our judgment is right, and here's the foretaste of the happiness you're going to have. And so it's sex, it's drugs, it's rock and roll, it's materiality, it's power, it's control, it's all these various things that are like, we think is our foretaste for the happiness that we're eventually going to have if we just pursue this line of judgment. So this is what they're, you know, they're after. So again, even the concept of flattening concepts, we flatten that concept. I'm both flattening concepts and not flattening concepts. I'm both experiencing bliss and not experiencing bliss. Now you might think, oh, that will prevent me from... No, that flattens the concept of experiencing bliss out. I'm both experiencing bliss and not experiencing bliss. I'm both experiencing peace and not experiencing peace. Because we're so addicted to judging, we'll immediately try to judge whatever experience we have. Okay, and this is the trouble, then all the thoughts and the yeast of judgment arises from that, and the dough of our experiencing suddenly becomes all frantic and erratic. So we must not judge our experience, but we will. So what do? We zero it out. We're so used to it, we feel that this is our functioning. Judgment is the way to happiness is judgment. That's what we believe. So to not be judging is too much for us. It's too frightening. I think most of us have had an experience of genuine bliss. I know I have. And then I'd start judging it, you know, either for or against it. As I've said before, don't judge for truth. Okay? Don't judge for what you really want. Don't judge for it. As soon as you do that, you're into judgment. And then it disappears on you. So what we do is we do judge, but we zero out the judgments. I'm both experiencing bliss and not experiencing bliss. I'm both happy and not happy. I'm both relaxed and not relaxed. So these are judgments, but they're in the form of a zeroed out judgment. And then this allows the bliss to remain, you see. Now, eventually, as we get better and better and better at that, doing that, and it may be easier and easier and easier and easier and easier, you know, to zero it out, zero it out, zero it out. I'm sure there'll be some progression like that, but see, I'm both progressing and not progressing. I've both succeeded and not succeeded. This is both success and not success. So we can use this to zero out judgment and then allow the bliss to remain with us. We can use this. As I said before, don't judge for truth. It's enough to not judge for truth. Okay, but how do we do that? We have this extreme habit of judgment, equating it with our happiness. Therefore, we are going to judge. So let's zero out the judgment. Now, this is the easy way. I mean, it's theoretically possible to try eventually, you know, very difficult, to finally just not judge at all. I mean, theoretically that's possible, but it may be extremely difficult and take a very, very long time. And what you arrive at when you do? Bliss. Okay? Whereas here, we can continue to judge, just zero it out, and we'll have bliss, same bliss, right now. As Buddha said, the wise are already on the other side. They're not trying to cross the river. Right? So by using this technique, we zero out judgment. Use judgment to zero out judgment. And that's enough. That's enough. So I said, we're not judging for truth or bliss. Yeah, I'm both experiencing bliss, which is a judgment that I'm judging for bliss. I'm experiencing bliss. And not experiencing bliss. And so when you, in that format, it's zeroed out, right? Zeroed out. And you don't need to judge for bliss. It's there. When judgment's zeroed out, happiness is there, you see? Happiness comes from no judgment. But zeroed out, well, what we do when we zero out judgment is we get this bliss. It's not the great bliss, but we don't need the great bliss right now at all. The great bliss only comes from actually the final, complete acceptance that beyond any possibility of immersion or non-immersion, you see. Then there's an even greater bliss, but that you cannot remain in a world with that great bliss at all. So that's not anyone's goal. Our goal is the bliss. You might say the bliss is a reflection of the great bliss, a reflection of the great bliss, a beautiful reflection of it. And once we get used to that beautiful reflection, then we're no longer concerned about the actuality that's being reflected, right? Then we can do away with the mirror altogether. But that's beyond the scope of anybody's practice here, actually. And so it's a non-starter. What we're doing is zeroing out judgment. So we don't, in not judging for anything, we don't need to judge for truth. Just zero out. So I'm both experiencing truth and not experiencing truth. I both love truth and don't love truth. I'm both happy and not happy. I'm both teaching and not teaching. I'm both understanding and not understanding. I both get it and don't get it. Yeah, I both get it and don't get it. Yeah, I both see it and I don't see it. Okay, keep in mind, we've thought that our happiness depends on right judgment. It does not. That's what our misery depends on. Our happiness depends on no judgment. So, once, you know, the more we get this clear about this, the easier it is to practice. Wow, a lot of stuff's working out in my neck. Holy cow. Now, there are plenty of people who are proclaiming that they want Jesus to return. All right. But here's the truth of the matter. They want Jesus to return after the catastrophes happen, which means it would be too late. So that what they really want is they want these catastrophes to happen, which will enable them to, what they think is to make a power play that they need to make and gain power over their enemies, which they're judging are preventing them from being authentically dead and therefore being resurrected and happy. So they always say, no, not yet, Jesus, not quite yet. But the fact is that this potential catastrophes are likely to be here in late September of this year. So if people are saying, oh yeah, well, Jesus is back soon, but not yet, they want to push it past, they're always trying to push it past the date of potential catastrophes. Potential, I'm saying. So the fact that Jesus is already back means he is well aware that the potential for these catastrophes is quite strong, actually. And so he has to come back before they happen, before, so he can introduce this truth of zeroing out judgment before the catastrophes may happen. So we have an option. So we can say, yes, we did have an option. And this option may stop it. Keep in mind, those who want the catastrophes, they don't want it stopped. They want them. So they're trying to have a cake and eat it to say, oh yeah, of course we want you to come back, Jesus, not quite yet. Why? Oh, well, we want these other catastrophes to happen so that we can gain the upper hand, and then we'll be happy. And that's, you want us to be happy, right, Jesus? So of course you want us to gain the upper hand. That's their reasoning. But for me, I've always said, no, Jesus, come back right now. Right now. Don't wait until after. Come back before. Come back before. This is when we need you, as before. He's already back May 1st, around that time. End of April, beginning of May. He already returned. He's already here. And he's already giving, you know, helping give this information out through those who are willing to do so. You cannot force it. You know, you say, well, how come this hasn't been given out all over the place? Well, you can't force it. You can't force anybody to do it. So it's entirely voluntary. I'm just doing it, volunteering to do it. I'm not being forced to do it at all. I'm doing it because I can, and it's right, and I'm prepared to do it. That's why it's helpful. I'm just like everyone else. I want happiness for everyone. It's just that I'm seeing, you know, that we've been pursuing it in the wrong way. And then this is, you know, through judgment, it doesn't work. And trying to judge authentic death, there isn't. It can't be. Spirit cannot die. So the way that Jesus has said, I agree. I said, this is the way. Now, you can talk about, you know, non-duality. You can talk. But there again, those who are doing that, what are they really waiting for? They're waiting for a catastrophe. They're waiting for something which will tilt things in the favor of their judgment as to what they think they need. So they're saying, well, I'm just waiting. You know, I'm just waiting for, you know, that. But meanwhile, let's talk about non-duality. That's a good way to wait. It keeps me enthusiastic about waiting, because I'm getting an idea of how happy I'm going to be once my judgment finally, you know, I get the blocks out of the way, the enemies out of the way, you know, that kind of thing. So it's the same thing. It's only practicing, you know. Well, we have three parts to our practice, you know, assertions, full stop on the wow, and flipping the script. So in flipping the script, I've been explaining, you know, the whole thing about catastrophes and how they happen and don't happen, and what we can do to avoid it, etc. And then the assertions would be saying, you know, I'm both succeeding and not succeeding. I both get it and I don't get it. Yeah, I'm both listening and not listening. Zeroing out judgment. These are the assertions, for instance, the practice. And then the full stop and the wow is where we don't judge our progress, you see. I'm both making progress and not making progress. Neutral. We go into this neutrality, say, wow. And we're quiet. And so this is the practice. I'm both practicing and not practicing. I'm both doing my homework and not doing my homework. I'm both reading and not reading. I'm both viewing this video and not viewing this video. I'm both hearing what is being said and not hearing what's being said. I'm both getting what's being said and not getting what's being said. I'm both accepting what's being said and not accepting what's being said. Very intense sneeze just tried to hit me. That's it, part of being impulsed, yeah. Wow. I was able to dissipate the impulse. I'm both being impulsed and not being impulsed. I'm both resisting and not resisting. Yeah, I'm both resisting and not resisting. I'm both taking medicine and not taking medicine. I'm both agreeing with you and not agreeing with you. So this is the way that we practice like this. And I'm both dedicated to this and not dedicated to this. I'm both agreeing to do this and not agreeing to do this. So everything is grist for the mill for this practice. It's a complete flattening out of all potential conceptuality, all of it. Infinite conceptuality, it's all flattened out. No judgment, not using judgment on any of it anymore. Except we are in the form of zero, flattened out. I'm both agreeing with this and not agreeing with this. Both accepting this and not accepting it. I like this format. It used the same word instead of trying to use some different word. Like, don't say, I'm both agreeing with this and disagreeing with this. It doesn't feel quite right. Say, I'm both agreeing with this and not agreeing with this. Try to use the same term. I'm both practicing and not practicing. Don't say, I'm both practicing and goofing off. No. Say, I'm both practicing and not practicing. That. I'm both tired and not tired. I'm both thinking and not thinking. I am both, yes. Yes, yes, yes. I am both thinking and not thinking. I'm both conceptualizing and not conceptualizing. I'm both blissing out and not blissing out. I'm both active and not active. I'm both considering this and not considering this. I'm both here and not here. Now, I'm feeling the wow of this. My pulse is boom, 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 like wow, wow. I'm both here and not here. I'm both an idiot and not an idiot. And we say it in a...
Yeah, I have...
We say it in an affirmative form, like yes. So it's a positive, yes. Yes, I'm both... positive and not positive. Yes. Yes, I'm both sad and not sad. But we're saying it in an upbeat, glasses half full way. Okay, we're saying it in a glasses half full way. Right? That's very important. Because we know the bliss is will be there when this is what's going to happen. So we're going towards our happiness. We are, truly. But from a conceptual standpoint, we say I'm both going towards my happiness and not going towards my happiness. I'm both doing good and not doing good. I'm both getting there and not getting there. I'm both being here and not being here. Yes. Yes, I'm very optimistic and not optimistic. I'm both very optimistic and not very optimistic. I'm both very spiritual and not very spiritual. So this is all said in a positive glass is half full vein. Okay. The level of the glasses is exactly the same. We can either say it's half full or half empty. We say it's half full because we say that happiness comes from no judgment, you see. Whereas others are saying happiness comes from right judgment. This is the mistake. And this is why we have righteousness, which is why Jesus said the righteous don't get into the kingdom of heaven. Plain and simple. Because righteousness means right judgment. They think that our judgment is right. But this is how we're going to get happiness by through it. This is how we get authentic spiritual death. And those others are just getting in my way, so I've got to get rid of them. So that they become righteous in their judgment. A lot of popping in my neck. The bones crack, crack, crack. Holy cow. I'm both well-adjusted and not well-adjusted. I both recognize truth and not recognize truth. I'm both willing to do this and not willing to do this. So it really doesn't take any more than this, and just say this with conviction. You know, I both have true conviction and don't have true conviction. Say that with true conviction. I both have true conviction and don't have true conviction. I am both optimistic and not optimistic. So it's as simple as saying this with conviction like this. This produces a wow. It's like shock treatment. But it's just very simple. We're like administering, you know, shock treatment to ourselves. So I'm just humming, you know, from saying this. Just, wow. But it's really this simple. It's this simple. Anyone can do it. Anyone can say the words. I'm both doing it and not doing it. I'm both doing it and I'm not doing it. I am both doing this and not doing this. I am both feeling this and not feeling this. I am both experiencing this and not experiencing this. So at least those of you who are hearing this, you realize, wow, there is a way. And maybe you say, well, maybe Jesus is back. And there certainly is a way, right? And we don't have to call catastrophe into our lives at all, actually. The option to call in catastrophe in our lives is practicing. It's easy practice. And say, I am both practicing and not practicing. See, this is the practice. I'm both practicing and not practicing. One moment here.
Yeah, you got him.
What's the emergency?
Well, in the way.
What?
both an emergency and not an emergency. Both a non-emergency and an emergency, you might say. So the potential catastrophe in my life has been averted, actually. I just sort of found out about that. There was a potential severe catastrophe in my life, and it's been averted. Pretty interesting. I didn't do anything except just keep taping and working. That's all I did. I did not react to it directly at all. There was definitely a situation which would be catastrophic for me, and I just said, well, I'm just going to keep doing what Jesus tells me to do, keep working, and we'll see what happens. That's all. So that's just what I did. I didn't focus on it at all directly. I just kept, and this practice came up. I said, okay, let's do this. And now I just found out that, no, it's not going to happen. It's been averted. So this is amazing. Oh, it's not amazing. It's wonderful. It's great. It's what I hoped for and expected. So we can avert catastrophes in our life, absolutely. And the way to do it is to work on zeroing out judgment. If we go down the path of judgment, there is no question that we will pull catastrophes into our life. There is no question, and drastic stuff will happen to try and, you know, give us the leverage we need to make a radical power play, okay? Whereas if we work on zeroing out judgment, catastrophes will be averted. They will not come into our lives. So this is super important. Now, what about Christianity? People might say, well, you're negative about it, positive. What? Well, here's the thing, that Jesus had to get the ball rolling. So he had to do accommodation. He had to accommodate us here, which he did. And so he knew that there would be all sorts of side-tripping about this. Okay, there has been. But still, it was a positive, very positive development, actually. Even though he knew it wasn't coming to a vacuum, so all the previous judgments and beliefs were then applied to Jesus and Christianity. So it's become this, you know, mishmash, which was expected, of course. And so, but overall, it has been, I would say, a big positive. Big positive. However, it's old wine at this point. You know, the actual form and format of it all is very old wine. Jesus says, don't pour new wine into old wineskins. It's going to burst them. So this practice is the new wine. So we're not saying this is Christianity. I'm using the term Jesus, but Jesus was never directly affiliated with any of the religions. That those were judgments about Jesus. Okay. But Jesus is the same now as he was before. And is not coming to bring, quote-unquote, a religion of judgment. He's coming to bring the freedom from judgment. And we do this through right practice. So, I use the name in that context. And I do honor the tradition of Christianity. You could say it's certainly one of the greatest traditions in history, if not the greatest tradition in history. There have been others too, but it certainly, you could say, is right up there at the top of you know, impactful traditions in the history of this world. So certainly the creativity and everything we've done, you know, this is to be honored. It's our creativity at play, along with the other traditions too. All everything we've done is the play of our creativity, play of the mind, the spirit, the one spirit. So that's the perspective. But so the crisis has been averted for now. But if we go into judgment, it'll come back. So you realize there's a lot of very judgmental people, attitudes in the world. People are being super judgmental and not practicing no judgment. I have to keep my back is like still trying to. There's a lot of. I guess I think the nervousness, you know, causing this is the buzz of this. This is the buzz of the times now. Is if you really see what's going on, holy cow. Old grievances are suddenly becoming aware that they've never been dropped, and they've actually, people have been planning their revenge for a long time, and now you're going to see the revenge. You see it in a lot of different ways. And catastrophes provide a cover for those who want revenge, provides the opportunity. You know, it's just like police action in a city or something provides the pretext for the people to start rioting and burning and looting and being destructive, you know, and attacking, etc. It gives them the excuse for revenge from what they see as grievances. So this is where the world is heading. Jesus said it would head this way. He's certainly right. We're told this, that, and we're told a great tribulation period will come. But it's just cover for grievance. It doesn't have to come. It doesn't really have to come at all. It's not set in stone. And it certainly doesn't have to come for us. If we're practicing setting down judgment, you know, it doesn't have to come for us at all. And whatever it takes to avert for the crisis not to occur to us, that's what will happen for us, really. And however that plays out, it will play out in the right way. So, you know, my life seems to be very, very potentially catastrophic, and it was almost plunged into it, and yet now it's been averted. And if I keep practicing this, perhaps it will start smoothing out and becoming better and better and better, and not so difficult. And so these videos are so important because they're presenting, you know, an option to really severe misery that many want to happen. They want severe crises to give them the excuse. They have a lot of people that have a lot of plans for the future and the way they want it to go. They need a crisis to excuse their activities. They absolutely do. And it's not just the president who does this. It's a lot of factions want this, actually. You know? He just happens to be in a place that has so much visibility that, you know, it's a good example to use. You'll never let a good crisis go to waste. Foment crisis and use it as an excuse to use executive orders, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This is standard operating procedure, but it's not. There's many factions who want a crisis. So let's not be myopic at all. So I can say, yes, I am both safe and not safe. See, that's a concept. Zero out the concept of safety. Reality doesn't need the concept of safety to be safe. And if we're entertaining a concept, you can always entertain the opposite concept, you see. And then judgment enters into it. And then you automatically feel that you're not safe. You're vulnerable. There's a vulnerability there. So we zero out the concept of safety. Yes, I'm both safe and not safe. Yes, I'm both going towards safety and not going towards safety. Now, you may be friends with someone, living with someone, etc., that you think is causing you a lot of problems, etc. Well, they may be the catastrophe that you think you need. But on the other hand, they can bring to life bring to light, you know, the pressure and put your focus on it. And if you use it in a positive way, say, hey, this glass is half full. That's what I did. Here's this a possible crisis. I said, hey, the glass is half full. Let me keep working on what I'm doing. I feel it's going to work. Let me not be distracted. So it turned into a big positive. Well, sure, it was a lot of work, but it was good work. I enjoyed it. So it's turned into a huge positive. So look at whatever is happening in your life. Look at that as a positive, that here's an opportunity to turn me towards right practice. So I am both relieved and not relieved. Zero out every concept. I'm both zeroed out conceptually and not zeroed out conceptually. I'm both free and not free. I'm both thinking and not thinking. I'm both hoping and not hoping. I am both wishing and not wishing. I am both relieved and not relieved. I am both grateful and not grateful. Now, again, I said, what about one of the teachings? They try to feel grateful, gratitude. Well, we are so addicted to judgment that it's not possible to directly tell people starting out, you know, hey, just zero out, say I'm both successful and not successful. They'll freak out. You can't do it that way. So what you first do is give them, say, practice positive judgment. This is the glass half full kind of thing. Get used to glass half fullness. And only after we've done that do we gradually start able to then go over and say, hey, you know, let's zero out judgment. So first you try to say, well, let's make sure you do the right judgment, and yet but move it towards no judgment. You see, this is what Jesus has to do. This is what he's done in A Course in Miracles, etc., is starting out a certain way and then gradually moving it towards no judgment. Because you can't just go to somebody who's absolutely convinced their happiness depends on judgment and just say, no judgment's the answer. Okay. They'll say, you're crazy. I'm not going to listen to you. So first, you have to at least introduce some positive judgments, you know, thinking, okay, this is what I need to do, but interlace it with hints, you know, and gradually familiar, and you gradually get more and more familiar and say, okay, it's like that. This is what, you know, has to be done. So hopefully there are those in the world who have already done this. So now they're at the point of saying, you know what, maybe I can just do this no judgment practice. This is really the highest practice. This is the true practice. And somebody can say, I'm both practicing true and not practicing true. Zero out that judgment. I'm both established in bliss and not established in bliss. I both have no mind and not no mind. I'm both abiding in the self and not abiding in the self. Was Ramana Maharshi abiding in the self? Not the conceptual self, no. So we could, you know, the best we could say about it, he was abiding in the self and not abiding in the self. Zero it out. We cannot define reality at all, so I both see it and I don't see it. So I went real big yesterday, and I'm trying to go real big today, even bigger today. I don't know how I'm going to do that. But, you know, I have to try. this is what we should do. Go big every day. Go big every day here. So I'm both going big and not going big today. Yeah. Right. I'm both right here. I'm both right here now and not right here now. I'm both going big now and not going big now. I both have a bright future and don't have a bright future. I've both had a miserable path and not had a miserable past. I've both suffered and not suffered. Now, I don't know if we should use the past term like that. I just tried it out to see, but maybe the present term is better. I am both suffering and not suffering. So I would say either the present for sure, and maybe the future, like I both have a bright future and don't have a bright future. I'm not sure if putting it in a past tense or a future tense is effective or not. My future is both now and not now. I'm both in the now and not in the now. Certainly it feels like the present tense is the preferable one here. I am both stupid and not stupid. I am both incompetent and not incompetent. Now, what do you say first, the negative or the positive? I don't know. I'm both competent and not competent. I am both smart and not smart. So these were affirming a positive first, whereas the others just say, I'm both stupid and not stupid. We're affirming a negative first and then using a double negative, not stupid. I'm both stupid and not stupid. Seems to me, though, the avoidance, the goal is the avoidance of affirming the positive, which would get in the way of actually experiencing it. So maybe it's better to use the positive form to lead off with the positive form. I am both positive and not positive. I am both well and not well. I am both righteous and not righteous. I am both successful and not successful. So again, what we're wanting to avoid is the judging of a positive outcome, of the bliss. We avoid judging it. So we need to identify it right off the bat. Oh, I am both blissful, which is the positive thing, and not blissful. So we zero out the judgment of it. So the abidance that we're looking for is a supremely positive abidance. So it's this which lends us to judgment. Say, well, how did I judge for that? You know, oh, right judgment. I use right judgment. I know I both used right judgment and didn't use right judgment. So right away, get on that. You know, oh, I both used right judgment and didn't use right judgment. Or I'm both sustaining this and not sustaining this. So this gives the mind a bone to chew on, you see. It gives judgment something to wrangle with. I'm both judging for this and not judging for this. I both did the right thing and didn't do the right thing. I both did the right thing and didn't do the right thing. I'm both saved and not saved. I'm both elated and not elated. Both elated and not elated. Again, the problem we all have is abiding in the bliss, abiding in it. So few abide in it. And so This is the whole situation we're looking at. I'm both abiding in it and not abiding in it. Zero it out. Judgment. Zero your judgment out. It's like a dog chewing on a bone. Let the dog chew on the zeroed out bone of judgment. I'm both relating and not relating to this. I'm both relating to this and not relating to this. I'm both enjoying this and not enjoying this. Don't form a concept about it. Zero out. Concepts arise so there'll be something to judge. Judge not lest ye be judged. Right? So if you judge for truth, you are also bringing up the option of judging against it, you see. So judge not lest you be judged. You automatically produce a past time, a past and future of and a, you know, judge. I can judge against it too. So I'm both judging for it and against it. I'm both judging for it and not judging for it. This is the better format. Don't say against it. I'm both judging for it and not judging for it. For this. I'm both judging for this and not judging for this. So, we don't want to judge against truth. We just say we're not judging for it. So, I'm both judging for this, which is what our inclination is, and then we say, and I'm also not judging for it. I'm both elated at this and not elated at this. I'm both experiencing elation and not experiencing elation. Now, are we experiencing elation? Yes, but we're talking about judgment, zeroing judgment out so we don't lose it, right? So we don't judge for it, which then puts it into the category of only potentiality, because we could also judge against it, and somehow we have to defeat judgment against it, you know, like that. So we say, no, I'm both judging for it and not judging for it. I'm both experiencing elation and not experiencing elation. I'm both experiencing peace and not experiencing peace. I'm both experiencing joy and not experiencing joy. I'm both experiencing love and not experiencing love. And this is all I have to say about it in terms of judgment. Goes. I'm zeroing it out. Yes, I'm both have something to say about it and don't have something to say about it.